First of all, this is gonna just talk a bit how different governance currently is about some of the ideas we have already been floating out on the list. And I think most of it actually should go to a discussion and hopefully we'll have some outputs that we really can then work on, move them towards GR and actually just make them live. That's at least the hopes that I have for this both. Yeah, first of all, where do we have our governance written in, or what documents do we have about? Of course, we have the Constitution, which should be a central document about our governance, but which isn't. Then we have some usual practices, like everybody knows that we do it this way. We have lots of different codes of conduct, something like the backstep and org descriptions, or FTP master scripts, quality assurance, developer reference, policy. Actually, they are something that governs how Debian works, even if you don't like it or sometimes, but anyways, that's where it's written sometimes. And also, our governance, even if we are sometimes unhappy with, at least I am, it mostly really works. So, it independent of what we change, we need to make sure that it's better afterwards and not broken afterwards. Because it's really, even if it's, in a lot of cases, not really democratic or whatever, it really works very well. So we should keep that in mind. So now our formal part of governance is, what is in our constitution? I just looked it up for this talk. Yes, because mostly we just don't see it, but our constitution says who has power in Debian, that are all developers together by a general resolution or by an election. The project leader, the technical committee, the individual developers, the delegates and the secretary. So, actually, there's some more governance we don't see by the individual developers, not by the by established teams somehow. I'm not having a definition what established means, but we definitely say have power. And of course, also, if you don't like it, but flame wars are great, well, I'm not saying source of helpful governance, but they change something. Often in a way we don't like. Yes, and formal governance. What does all developers mean by a general solution? They often take very long to come to the side. I don't know how long it took for the solution about the firmware GR exceptions for Edge. 3 months, 4 months, something like that.
And even then it was not really resolved.
It wasn't resolved. We just had a status where we could survive for a few more months. So it's very painful often for us. So we actually don't use it so often because our experience are so bad. And elections, well, there's actually only one election in Debian, and that's a Debian project leader. Then, yeah, as I said, basically, actual governance by all developers, not really much. The project leader has the formal governance what the project leader has. He has the power to delegate and redelegate tasks, and even to undelegate tasks, and to do this forcefully. He can make any decision which requires urgent action. Then he can make decisions about property and thus organizations, but he cannot override decisions which are already done by delegates. So actually, it looks a bit different. I can remember only one forceful redelegation, but I'm a Debian developer only for 4 years now. That was actually the redelegation of the DevConf venue decision for this year's DevConf, by the way. What are you laughing, Morgan? Oh yes, policy team. You are right. A second time, I've just forgotten. But actually, delegations, so you see how much important it was actually after all. But delegations are only very seldom used. They're not the main source of power in Debian. I personally cannot remember any urgent action decision happened anymore. And but as I said, I'm only a Debian developer now for 4 years, so it might have been before. Yes, of course, what he regularly does is he makes decisions about Debian property, mainly means giving out money for hardware, for meeting, whatever, which is of course a fairly important task, and which seems to work fairly well. What he also does, which isn't in the constitution, he's a representative of the project. He travels to conferences, attends conferences for Debian, makes keynotes, whatever. And even not only the actual current DPL does it, even the former DPL still do it on a regular basis. And DPL actually, he needs to convince the people in Debian if he wants to change something, which isn't in the constitution, but which is actually the way it's happening now. It's a technical committee, could decide any on technical policy, decide any technical matter where developers' jurisdictions overlap, overrule a developer by a certain majority only, and its members are not elected this time, but they co-opt new members in if needed. Details these in the constitution, just in general, how it generally works. So actually, we overrule not so often, I think. I can remember one case where we actually overruled and put that to force, and we overruled Valdi on permissions of some strange device nodes. We actually just removed the overruling of the MD5 sums. And some people, especially the one person, tried to use it to escalate non-technical issues, which we just didn't like. So the individual developers, of course, they are a very important part, because most things that don't happen on an attention level that most of us see, but just happens on a day-to-day basis, and that's what the normal developer do. Yes, so that's what their governance, and which is both in the constitution and which actually happens. Delegates actually have the powers delegated to them by the project leader. They even may make certain decisions which the project leader himself may not make, like expelling the developers. So that's from the constitution corporate. But actually, delegates are not the way how we do it normally in Debian. Someone starts working on tasks, becomes better on the task, becomes somehow a senior person, then has a certain task, a certain responsibilities, without being delegated. We have cases where we are not sure if someone is really delegated or not. And delegations don't need to be public. The DPL could make a private delegation that someone is now superloaded all Debian machines, and you can just make it private. Probably it won't be effective anyways, but. That's about delegates. Yes, so what we have as governance, which is not part of the constitution, but which actually is an important part of our governance, is we have established teams, basically, say, co-op new members somehow, like the release team does from time to time. Other teams do it by different ways. For example, the quality assurance team has now obviously the right to forcefully orphan packages of other maintainers. Because they are doing it for something like 5 years now, and nobody really complained, except one developer who has been expelled for other reasons.
Well, the people who would complain aren't around.
Pardon?
The people who would complain about that are typically not around, so.
Yes, somehow it works. So actually, I would say they have the power now because they are doing it for 5 years, so yes, that's okay. And basically, the established teams are the real power centers in Debian. All the important teams are somehow not delegated, co-opting new members, and just working somehow. So, there are some ideas for future governance we have discussed about, or that has been discussed about elsewhere. There have been the ideas of a Debian project leader team to say the tasks are too much for one person. So it has been obviously not been so large success that the developers voted for another one again who wanted to have a team. Last year, Anthony had co-DPL, which is, I wouldn't call two persons a team, but it's still different from what the constitution says, and which, at least in my opinion, works fairly well. There has been a recent discussion about a social committee to add to the technical committee. And one question for me is, do we delegates as we have now in the constitution are not what we actually using, so should we reform it, or do we just want to get rid of delegates at all? And replaced by something else, which might work better? And is there a way, and do we like to include the established teams somehow in our constitution, so that our constitution and our current practice match better to each other? Yeah, social committee, do we need it? Should it be the same as a technical committee or something else? I see a lot of reasons for not, but I think we should discuss about it. Should the people inside of it be elected or just co-opt themselves in? Well, of course, the first round needs to be elected, but otherwise, later on, should that be elected always or only on the first time? Yes, so that was for an introduction. As I see many people, I think we definitely have a good discussion. I will try to keep myself a bit out of the discussion, hoping that that will help us to get to results. So thank you very much for your attention. And I see Manoj as first already. Okay, I would say first members of the technical committee and then other people. Okay, do we have a microphone? Peter? Okay.
I have two comments.
Sorry.
No, it is. It was.
Hello?
Yes, yes.
The first one was about the minor little detail about the policy. I don't think it goes into governance because it is technically supposed to be, even though it currently is not, it's supposed to be a technical document that tells you whether your package is working correctly or not. It is not supposed to have the governance aspect built into it.
You can just answer to that. Actually, I didn't say these are the documents that want to describe how the governance works. I just said these are the documents. Basically, that is where you can read about the current Debian governance somehow. The documents are not all coherent. Some are conflicting, but basically, if you read all of them and look a good bit at the mailing list, you'll see how most parts work. I think that's a correct description of the current status, without anything saying it's, I like it or not. Just, is it that way?
The second part that I had was about current themes. I'm not sure that it is obvious that any team in Debian, just because it was formulated before we had a constitution, somehow stayed out of the jurisdiction of the constitution when we adopted the constitution itself. If you go back and look at the vote, it was, for the people who voted, it was unanimously accepted. And arguably, at that point, all power, everything that allows you to use Debian resources was redirected to flow back down through the election, through the project leader, and back down to the delegates. Whether or not the current delegates acknowledge that they are delegates is another issue. If there is some confusion in that regard, I suggest that we kind of create new delegates who agree with our constitution and
Call
power over.
Actually, I think that really interesting point here is, Manoj, that, well, of course, from looking at the former side of the constitution, I fully agree with you. But actually, I think also, looking at how Debian works, we don't, just basically, we don't use the constitution as often as we could, and it works very well. So I'm not always sure that one has to adjust a little bit to the constitution, but sometimes also other way. I'm currently not sure which is the correct thing. I just think we have to acknowledge that currently the established teams, and some even established after the constitution was created, like the release team, that the established teams somehow have a lot of power and are not seen as delegates. And whatever we like it or not, we can discuss afterwards and then say, and how would we like it to be? I think that's the important question. Should we adjust at a few parts the reality? I think that's true. In another part, we might perhaps need to adjust the constitution. It's also okay. Probably both.
Yeah, I completely agree with what Andy said. So when I originally wrote that bit about delegates, I definitely had in mind precisely these teams. But it's quite reasonable for somebody else to hold a different view. And I don't think we should, for example, take the view that we should fire people who are doing a good job because they have some disagreement about some technical governance matter. The problem we have really at the moment is because our actual practice and our formal constitution are so different, it makes it difficult to fix difficulties with these teams because they're so much outside the normal flow of the power structure and the de jure and the de facto are so different. And we really need to, as Andy says, I think we need to adjust the constitution to recognize the situation. And hopefully we can come up with something that everybody will not be hopelessly unhappy with.
Yeah. So, next one.
Okay, I just wanted to say that they are respecting the constitution. The sole point is that they think they are not illegal. It means if we do a jeer to say something else to the to say he say is delegate or the keeping master are delegates, they will accept the outcome. It's just that currently they don't think and they say so that they are not delegates. But they do respect the constitution.
Actually, anything I said, or at least if somebody understood me as I would say somebody doesn't respect the constitution, that would be totally wrong. I'm quite sure that everybody in Debian really respects the constitution, or at least almost all, especially all people in the established teams really accept it. So they see it perhaps differently, and some of them don't really see the constitution as something that is, well, or no influence of the constitution that they were, which doesn't mean they don't respect it, it just doesn't have any impact, which a bit of differencing. Actually, I want to add a small warning about the current system of delegates, because it looks a bit inconsistent to me to say, well, we have one person who can just de-delegate and undelegate whatever he likes, but he cannot override any decision of the delegates. That looks, yeah, at least funny to me, but perhaps that's also my European influence on it. So, yeah, perhaps it might also help to say, well, we change the way delegates work and then bring the new teams into that new way of whatever we call it then. So, last is, I think, the next one.
Well, I think one of the issues is, what are we actually trying to fix? I mean, I think that various different people have different opinions on that, and that's one of the reasons why it's hard to talk about governance, because you know, I think people are coming from different perspectives on what actually is wrong and what we're actually trying to fix. I think there feels like there's a set of people who feel like, who have a problem with the fact that the governance structure is informal in practice, and that we don't really use the structures of the Constitution to change things frequently. And even if the current governance structure is working well, we should make the formal description of the governance structure match what we're currently doing if we think what we're currently doing works well. I think there's one camp like that. I think there's a different camp that feels like what we're doing right now doesn't work well, and what feels like we should be applying the Constitution to change it. I think the most common objections there are usually around transparency or membership in core teams or things along those lines. And you know, those are two really different kind of directions to take at the thing, and it's not clear whether the folks that want to have specific problems that they want to fix really care whether the formal governance matches the informal governance, or they just want the problem to go away, and if we can do that informally, that's fine. And part of this goes into this is that many of the problems we're running into, particularly the problems we're running into that are around the social committee proposals, they're hard problems, and it's not clear that they're governance problems. They're social problems, and coming up with a governance structure means that you have a structure in which to deal with them, but it doesn't mean that you can necessarily resolve them. You still need to have people who can work with other people. And you know, all the written constitutions in the world don't give you that necessarily.
So next one is Colin. I've seen Colin. Okay, Colin, I don't mind. Colin is an I.
Do I? Am I in line? Right. So basically, in the issue of governance, I think we are beating around the bush here. So the core problem that we have had in the last few years, maybe few, maybe eight, maybe I don't know how many, is that some infrastructure teams cannot be overridden by anyone, including the account managers and the system administrators. Problems in those teams cannot be escalated anywhere. No, there is no higher instance. So in effect, they are as powerful or more powerful as the project leader. So what are we trying to fix? These teams have to be fixed in a way that's orthogonal to the solution is orthogonal to whether we have a formal method of electing them or an informal method. We don't have any method of fixing them. So that's the. I mean, we should concentrate on the concrete problem, not you know, social committee may fix some social problems. This and DPL team might fix this other problem, but the core problem is that we are not doing something basically essential. You know, someone has to have the balls to go to the team member who is being completely, you know, obstructing to the process and say, okay, you're not doing your work very well. Yeah. Okay, everybody thinks you're not doing that work very well. Can you please either step aside or teach someone else or, I don't know, have a cookie or something? You know, we need to do something about concrete problems. You know, none of these other team problems are so critical as the teams that cannot be overridden. So I think that's the main problem with governance in Debian.
Okay. So next is then Colin.
So I was going to make another comment in response to Russ, but firstly, I think one of the original intents of the distribution, and Ian, I'm sure can correct me if I'm wrong, was that people who are doing the work should not be arbitrarily overridden by somebody who hasn't been doing the work, by somebody who's elected to govern the entire project. We may have gone a little too far in the. There are no checks sometimes, but I don't think we should drift all the way to having nothing but checks and balances and people get ripped out of their jobs every year because the Debian project leader doesn't like the color of their hair or whatever. I think it is worthwhile to continue considering the people who are doing their jobs well, that they have a certain rights to stay in positions they're in because by virtue of the fact that they're doing a good job. The other thing I wanted to say in response to Russ was that as far as established teams are concerned, I'm largely in Works Well camp. The Works Well that needs to be clarified. For the bugs.epic.org admins, I was active in that team for a few years, not anymore, but still present. One of the problems that we occasionally saw, and it wasn't a large problem, but it was there, was that people that had no, there was no visible basis for why we had the access we did to Debian property, the bugs.debian.org server, you know, where this authority to run these machines came from. And I think eventually some DPL said, everybody who is in these positions is hereby delegated and make the problem go away. But in the eyes of many people, it was a problem for a while that we found ourselves addressing.
Okay. Now we have, okay, Peter wants to make an administration of the market, which is of course distant. Then I want to say something, Joy, and then I. Okay, now for Peter.
The only thing I want to say is please speak close to the mic because I love you.
Thank you. I hope now to follow your advices. Okay. And also, if you are not introduced already yourself, please say your name. Again, so what I want to say to you, I think I'm in a different camp than you said. I'm in a camp where I just say, when actually what we do mostly works. I know that there are a few problems like Joy said, but actually most things works. And what I really don't like to see is that we have one constitution, a totally different set of practices, and there's no way to fix problems if they appear because we just don't apply the constitution in reality. So I want to bring these two near together and find a way how to fix the issues in the core teams in case we might have one. And so now Joy is the next one.
Well,
Ian. Okay. Where's the microphone?
I've seen you, Manoj.
So I just made a list of the types of disputes, right? We're talking about governance. Governance is about conflict and about how we decide what we do when people disagree with each other. And I've got a list of five things here that we've been arguing about. So we've got the core teams problem, which some people think is more of a problem than others, and certainly there's been a lot of argument about that, and our current mechanism is not working. You can tell it's not working because no decision has been taken. And our governance mechanism has failed because it's not taken a decision. We've had a lot of copyright licensing arguments, and it's evident that our system there is quite broken because we keep having to escalate our decisions to our kind of ultimate authority and pass general resolutions, and this proves that Debian legal is broken. We've got the problem of people flaming and being useless and crappy and not getting on with each other. And normally, you would, in any normal situation, you'd give people a bit of a private warning and then you ban them from mailing list or something. Or every other normal organization has some mechanism like that. And we don't have a mechanism like that as well. So again, we have to escalate it to the most extreme possible sanctions. We do have one more or less working thing, which is the technical committee, although it's suffering very much from nobody bringing any questions to it at all. Because, well, if you're involved in conflict and disagreement in Debian, every other area of disagreement in Debian is enormous doom. And if you have an argument with somebody, the last thing you want to do is to escalate it because it's just going to become terrible. So I think people are just not used to that. And then, of course, there's Dunk Tank, which I don't want to say anymore about.
Okay, next on our Manoj and then Frater Franz.
What you said about technical committee not getting questions. My experience with technical committee is that they are very good at postponing decisions about tough subjects. Yes, I mean the two bug reports that Sven filed in this case. And I think that's unfortunate because that actually contributed to the fact that everything continued. So it would be nice that if the technical committee is offered an issue, that they would actually deal with the issue instead of just delaying it.
Manoj?
Coming back to whether we need to change the constitution or we need to change our current practice, if the current practice is working and differs from the constitution, I guess it does make sense that we go back and fix the constitution. I think that if you took an informal poll, you'd find that most people think that our current government structures are broken. So we don't want to hard code all that back in our constitution, because it would just make it harder to fix. We need to fix the problems first, and then put in the fixed government structure in the constitution.
So the next ones are now Mies and Baxis and Russ. So actually, Manoj, what the interesting thing is that our daily governance obviously works. If it wouldn't work, we wouldn't neither sit here nor have any release done in the last 5 years. Nothing else would work. So actually, what we do on a day-by-day basis works very well. I think we most agree to that. But actually, what doesn't work are some, I would say, already high-escalated issues and topics. We all know, like you said before, there's no way, for example, to really override the Debian system administrators, unknown if it's necessary or not. And of course, I wouldn't like an easy way to say, well, the current DPL can just replace all of them, which might have followed from our current constitution, but which also wouldn't be the right thing for governance, because governance should, in the end, not solve social problems, but help in making problems less escalated and makes people working agree to a common solution. I think that's part of good governance, that people can, after popular solution, work together again and better than before. And that's something I would like to achieve. So now, Foxy.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that our current model is a cooptation mainly for most teams. It's true for Alias, it's true for BDS, it's true for list masters everywhere. And it's the same model that is used by the problematic teams for DSA, FTP master. The only thing is that we have problem with the members who are not really acknowledging the fact that they are lacking manpower. And over that, there's also personal problems between members of those teams, which have evolved over the years. And you don't get to solve that by deciding it. You need to speak with each other. It's private issues, and it's difficult to go forward. But in any case, I'm not sure that firing them is the right solution. I'm sure it's not, in fact. And just wanted to respond to Joy as well. Yes, we have a way to override them if you want to. We have GR, and they will respect any outcome of a GR. It's just that we avoid that whenever possible. If needed, we will come to that one day, sure. Thus, can we just allow Joy to answer that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was maybe too much concentrating on we don't have a method to escalate, and when we do have a method to escalate, it's always to the top authority. You know, we don't have medium solutions in our governance model. We don't have a governance model. We have one and zero. You know, it's pretty much binary. Either it just happens and it works, or, well, it doesn't work. And there's basically no way to fix it, which is barely amicable. You know, we only have unfriendly ways to fix things, and those are ways to fix things. They are a way to change things, but you can't make giant changes like that.
Okay, I will open my okay. So now next, last, Colin, Sam.
Okay, you.
So.
Steve, I've seen you.
So I want to get back to one of the previous points, which was the point of the idea of governance is that you is making decisions, and if you don't make a decision, you haven't actually exercised governance. I think that that's a really vital thing to keep in mind in terms of success. If we think about what having good governance, having better governance in Debian means, I think a lot of that involves actually making decisions and in a way in which everyone in the project agrees that a decision was actually made. We make a lot of decisions by default, or we make a lot of decisions by ignoring the problem until one side or the other of it gives up. And there's also a lot of decisions that have been made implicitly but have never been made explicitly, which I think contributes a lot to the flame wars, because it leaves open the possibility for people to argue endlessly that there's no actual decision that's ever been really made. You know, I think this has come up in several different respects, but to take one that I raised recently on Debian Vote, we have these criteria that are being applied as near as I can tell. I mean, I'm a fairly new Debian developer, and I don't know for sure about some of these things, but it seems like we have these criteria that we're applying to judge licenses, the Desert Island test, the Chinese dissonant test, or I think dissonant test that's been renamed. And they don't exist in the stated form anywhere in our documents. You know, people disagree to some extent over whether or not they're implied by different pieces of the social contract or so on and so forth, but that's a dispute. People don't agree that whether or not those are actually part of our license evaluation. So a successful governance in that area would be making a decision and having everyone in the project agree whether they like the decision or not, that a decision was actually made. You reach some sense of conclusion on the topic, and maybe we then don't keep discussing, and we don't keep having some people progressing with the idea that the decision wasn't made and some people progressing with the idea that it was.
Okay, so, okay, then Sam is next. And Steve after.
Okay, I'll be talking about the core teams first.
Are you speaking as DPL or as developer?
I'm speaking as DPL.
Okay.
Well, the question whether the teams could be overridden or not has already been addressed. So I agree that a GR can override these teams, and I know of no one in the delegated or not delegated teams who would disagree with the results of a GR. However, I can perfectly live with these teams not believing they are delegates if there are other ways to fix them. So it's true that these teams are either broken or dysfunctional or anything. And I also believe they cannot fix themselves alone. That's why I'm trying to help them. I also said in my platform that I would add new people to these teams, and I never said that I would fire anyone from these teams, or at least I don't remember saying that. Because the people in this team, I would hate to see them go away from the team or even from Devon, and if you don't handle things carefully, this is the kind of thing that might happen. Because, I talked about five problems in Debian, and I think that they are all more or less related to people not getting along together very well. And so there's a lot of mediation required, and I'm really working on that. I want you to believe me about that, and I think it will eventually work. However, even if I don't believe GR to I don't know, make a revolution inside Devon is a good idea. It's always possible if you believe it's not going fast enough, but try to trust me on a few things, and please come talk to me about it. Don't hesitate to tell me anything about what you believe is going on and what you don't know, and I will share the information I have that I believe can be shared and made public or semi-public. I will not disclose anything private, because there are private matters that are really important concerning the relationship between people that I will not disclose. But please talk to me about it. If it's just to tell me there's a problem about this, and just to get an idea of how many people believe there's a problem. But of course, if you want to help and talk to other people and so on, that's also very welcome. I have so far received a lot of offers to help to integrate the other teams and talk to them and do work that can be helpful to them, and that's really great.
Okay, so now next is Steve.
Hi. One of the biggest issues that I've seen while I've been in Debian for the last few years is, a lot of the teams we've been talking about already, and some of the other teams, is frankly just burnout. We've got too many people involved in too many teams. They don't have the time to either do the job they want to do. They're all still committed people. They don't have the time to do the jobs that they've agreed to do. They don't have the time to tell other people what they're doing. They don't have the time to help new people get started. So that's where we end up with a lot of our problems. We need a way of easing those people out, of trying to help them as much as possible. Instead, we've ended up with some disagreements on mailing lists where they get flamed. They don't even see some of these discussions that are going on, but because they're seen as being quiet and not getting involved, they get flamed for it. If we can somehow ease that, I'd love some ideas on this, that would be a very big help for all of us.
Okay, so I've put myself on the list, and if it's, I said it's David, then it's Joy. Okay, then it's okay. So now it's getting about the borders of memory to remember how many people. So these are more than four people in advance. So okay, now what you four have said before about our five different issues. Yes, I think we have a different areas issues, and it's not all about FTP masters. Even so, we sometimes have issues. Actually, most part of what FTP master's role is about actually works. Our archive works, we can upload packages, new is processed, removals are processed, perhaps not as often as I would have liked, but they are processed from time to time. So most parts, even in the teams that people that have been flamed quite often, list, I would say this way now, even these parts mostly work. So we really need to be a bit of careful to just fix the issues and not do overdo it anyways. And I think we have more issues than only speaking about the teams. On the other hand, Sam, I need to disagree a bit with you. You said that most problems are social problems. I doubt that, for example, the licensing issues are not social at all. And whether we apply the desert island test or not it's not a social question. We just need to decide one day, we do it, we don't do it, and then we are done. And I have a personal opinion on it, but even if it would end different than I would like, I would still prefer that situation to further discussion. So, because then we have just a decision we can work on, we can live with, or if someone can't live with, he needs to make his own conclusions from it, but anyways, we can work from there on and go on to the next issues. So I think there are a lot of things we can solve, some we can't solve, some are a little bit more social. I agree to that part. So, okay, now the next one, please.
So this actually goes, back to what Steve was saying about burnout and stuff. When I started working on the Strike Force and stuff, it was very clear right off the bat that there was no sort of roadmap for how to maintain a team or how to run a team. And we really don't have that. For individual developers just working on their own, we have policy, we've got developers reference, we have a lot of guidelines to help people along and to do things correctly. For running a proper team and structuring a team correctly, we don't have anything like that. And I think that's what allows this sort of thing to happen, where people get burned out, they don't know how to give up the reins, there's no sort of, you know, here's what you need to document or how you need to document it. I've been sort of thinking for the past couple of years about how to document these things and create sort of a structure within the Strike Force. You know, how to override the team leader, or how to kick the leader out, or, you know, if it's, you know, all these things that might need to happen. What?
How to pass on gracefully.
Exactly. How to pass on gracefully. How just to deal with all these problems. I mean, we don't have that sort of thing. That's why these things escalate to where we do have structure for this large-scale governance. I think within the teams, we need some sort of model with which each team can draw on to sort of govern each team individually. And that
would go on.
What?
It is what Joey had. Just go look at what Joey did.
Right.
DI
was my model, actually. Yeah, my time on the DI team was my model for the Strike Force, and it seems to work very well.
Okay, so now I have to admit the mistake, because I've ignored some of the quite some while. So if you would like to be the... You would want to say something, I think? And then you go to Troy, you... Andreas, so, yeah, okay.
Most of the DDM decisions are taken online, you know, with managed discussions, GA, email, voting system, and whatsoever. But during the last 5 years, I've seen some teams actually making decisions with face-to-face meetings. And it's now the seventh NetConf. Why not introduce some kind of formal time of face-to-face decision meeting and decision-taking time inside that conf, that we could, I don't know, make tough decisions face to face, you know, debating that lively, so we could sort things out more quickly. There is actually tools to enable people to take decisions, being more than 200 people in the same room. I will like make a list that is called like Spokas Council, and there is a few other methods. It's just something I think about.
So okay, next is Joel.
A little bit a concrete thing. Anthony Towns, in one of his mails to the project mailing list about a couple of weeks ago, mentioned a method that would rejuvenate the teams, like a method that when new members could apply, and then how the old members would accept them and all those things. And then I replied, and I wrote it out a little bit more time frames and things like that. So that's one way of achieving a higher goal. A higher goal would be making the teams layered. So there isn't just the binary state: either you are in the team or you are out; either you rule or you suck. You know, that's not the way it should be. And at the same time, I'm both the one who complains and the one about whom other people complain. You know, I'm one of those old farts, new farts. How do you say that? I've been here around, and then I went on a hiatus. You know, burnout, as Steve just said. It wasn't really burnout. I was just drifted away one day. You know, and I was gone. And I thought I had made, you know, all the steps necessary so that the universe doesn't implode without me, and the universe indeed did not explode without me or implode, but some things really died out without me, and some things were stuck for months, or even some are even stuck today because I went missing. So let's not get into the talk. You are not in the team. You don't understand how hard it is, or you don't know what burnout is. I just like that to be noted. I have been on the receiving end and on the giving end of that whole problem. So I still think that we need to make many layers, make escalation possible, make small escalations possible. And one of the concrete things is what Anthony proposed, and I recommend everyone to read the project mailing list.
Okay, so now I've just noticed, I just noticed there's about 20 minutes left. So, and I think I have now about 10 people who wanted to say something. So who really wants to say something before we finish here? I would please ask to raise the hand again, so that we finish with all the people who, okay? So, we now know all, I think Sam will have the last word, as DPL. So other people, please no new people anymore after that. And then we can finish and of course continue discussion afterwards. So.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that all of the governance in the world isn't gonna make people get along. And the most important thing is that everybody, respect each other, and if you're wrong, you're being wrong. I think that's a very important point. And one other thing I wanted to say is that I read Martin Michelmeier's PhD thesis, and he makes an interesting case for time-based releases. And of course, I'm not going to endorse it, but I do think that might be some governance thing that you guys might want to think about.
Okay, Andreas?
I think that we have a two-edged problem generally with regard to making decisions and leadership in general. On the one hand side, we don't have a process, not a practice, to develop leaders inside of Debian. We don't have a smooth way of someone growing into a leadership role. And on the other hand side, we don't have a process of people gaining trust into a leader. We need to have both. And the one way of having that is the small teams that I have been talking about for years, which would make it easy to both help leaders carry responsibility slowly, more, perhaps discover a new leadership talent in the group, develop him or her, and also see the other people in the group have other people in the group see that this person gets better and actually is trustworthy. And perhaps there could be some process in place or some, to give talented people more responsibility over time so that they could perhaps become more of a, we need leadership in the end. And no one actually believes, I think, that anarchy is the answer. Thank you.
Okay, so as far as I remember now, as next on the list, Steve, me, Baxi, Ayn, Colin, Sam, and Cecil. If anybody is left out, please say so now, otherwise, no word for you. So, okay, Steve.
Hi. Another point, moving on, switching from burnout, we've got a lovely habit of getting small teams who do things. We end up with small teams, a bit one person, two, three, whatever, who end up being the only people who actually ever really look into a problem. If you show that you can get that you can do a task and you can do it well, nobody ever really comes over to help out. At least that's my experience. Which of course means that at the point that you keep on getting busier and busier and busier, it's very easy to get actually quite resentful that you don't get help. But equally, it's very difficult to pass over the ways to start trusting other people to get them involved. AJ and I talked a little bit last year. I'm not going to steal this; it was his idea. He had a suggestion briefly that we might do the bus factor test, to pick randomly from core teams, maybe once a month or so. We pick somebody and say, right, you've been hit by a bus, you do nothing in that area of Debian, and let's see how well we cope. That would be a lovely incentive to actually force people to document what they do and to help hand over to others.
Okay, so I think it was now me on the road. Actually, I want to say that we have a lot of teams in Debian. I think even some of them work very well. Of course, I might be biased if I speak about the release team. But for example, we handed over maintenance, or we generated new members of the release team in the way that we asked the Debian developer announced. Say, well, we need new people now. Because, if I remember correct, 7 persons who had interest. Then we make for them tasks and skills twice, basically like the new NM process, to teach them what we need to do, the knowledge that they need to have. And at the end of this process, we had 4 people left. Now,
and you also check commitment by doing that?
Yes, of course. We check commitment, we check whether they can do it, whether they are able to do it, whatever. At the end, we had 4 people who survived the process. We went even hard. We trusted everybody who were able to answer to both mails. It was accepted. Which isn't too hard, yes? But from these 4 people, now basically, yeah, I would say two to three people are still in the release team, 2 people dropped out. So you see how it is. And we needed 4 months to check that. So on the one hand, it's a lot of effort, and on the other hand, it was worth it. Because one of the people is now the new Debian release manager, or one of the 2 new release managers. So yes, it was worth. We were able to hand over the tasks. And I'm in a very happy situation to say that this now, well, when Colin passed out, it was an easy way handover, I think. When Steve passed out, when Steve doesn't want to be in the hot seat anymore, he doesn't get out, thanks God. It was also a good and nice way. So yes. I think we have a part of Debian where it works well, then we have other parts where it doesn't, and we should try to make more parts working well. But it could be different working well for different parts, that to say. So, okay, next is, I think, who is it? Yes, you.
Okay, what you say is nice, but it doesn't work for all teams. I believe for the release team it works well because it's a high visibility task and people are interested and want to be like you and like all the release managers.
That's nice. Thank you very much for the nice compliment.
But I tried the same for Alias and really it didn't work the same. I mean, we have recruited Stephen Grun, but we didn't have 5 people to choose out. I mean, I'm quite happy that he's capable of doing the work and confident with him, but it doesn't work always that way. So just a tiny moment. And I wanted to reply to David. You told we have no guidelines for running a team, and I fully agree with you. That's why I recently started this wiki pages, wiki.debian.org/teams, and I recently added a guidelines sub pages there where I contributed my experience of IELTS administrator and how I run this team. And I'd like that other people like you will contribute to these pages and that we make it more useful so that we can have by default working teams. And then effectively we must acknowledge that we have teams that will not always work or that will work during 2 or 3 years but after that are blocked, and we have to find a good way to unlock the situation. And here I believe that something around the idea of HE is potentially interesting. I mean, maybe we could give a sort of consensus where a DPL could say, okay, I really believe this team doesn't work anymore, we need to add new people, and we should have something, a process where we people candidate, explain what they would like to do within this team, and then we have the current members of the team who should say what they think of each candidacy, and then a vote by the developers at large to just unlock the situation and have something clear for the future. I don't know what you think of that. I think it's worth to think about it a bit more.
So this is not really relevant to most of what's been said here, but I've just asked the scheduling system to make us a BOF for the social committee or social dispute resolution.
which is something we've not really discussed very much here, and probably a separate topic.
We already have one.
Oh, is it on the schedule?
We already had the BOF for that, asked Andreas Tille before. So I'm just looking up when it is, and we'll say so.
The last day, Andreas Schulte registered something about South Korea.
I will look it up, this
should,
continue
discussion. We should
one. We should have one. There will be one BOF, come to that BOF.
We have still half an hour?
Yes.
Then the schedule on the web is wrong.
No, Panda is mine.
Oh, okay.
Just reload the page.
That's typically to hide problems behind.
So following on from what Andy said, and I acknowledge your point that the release team is slightly unusual, but it is worth noting that that's the second time that release management has been handed over in a reasonably effective way. Anthony did the same thing when Steve and I joined. And since we have there a model of something that has at least on some level been working reasonably well, and since the FTP master team did something fairly similar recently, it's one of the things that we should be doing in building up guidelines for folks who are running small teams within Debian is, here are some examples of where it's been done right. Rather than we have a tendency of pointing out all the problems, all the bits where things are going wrong, but we should be pointing out the examples that actually work as well.
Actually, the problem is now that we really seem to have reached some point that we most agree on, so that we really could have Sam his closing words and then try to work on the issues that we had. Would that sound fair to you, or would you have some more discussion?
We could just split up and have informal discussion afterwards.
Yes, informal discussion afterwards, of course. That's the sense of that thing to have a webconf. So, Sam?
All right, so two additional comments. First of all, you have probably noticed that I haven't set up a DPL board or team or a second in charge or anything. That's mostly because I don't feel the need to dilute leadership when I can handle things myself. But of course, if you have things you would like to do, you're five people and you would like to be the social committee or something like that because no one else stood up to do the job, well, just come to me and I'll make you the social committee or something. It's probably not as simple, but that's the idea. And second thing is, Luna talked about face-to-face meetings. Awesome how face-to-face meetings can help solve things and have the language barrier be broken and DevConf is really great in that area, but we shouldn't wait for one whole year each time to have new face-to-face meetings. In fact, there are a few meetings planned. The release team already had a meeting. If you want to do a meeting with your team or to talk about a specific thing that you didn't have time to talk about at DevConf, just write to the leader address and say you need money for train or plane or anything, and just don't choose a meeting area in Hawaii or I don't know where. But we have thousands of dollars that I want to use to sponsor meetings, so just write and you'll probably get the money for sponsorship and maybe posting if we can find any sponsor for this. I know a few people are not very familiar with how it works, and people wrote to me and were quite reluctant to ask for money because they didn't know how it worked, but just say you want to go to this place and it's say why it's good for Debian, and having a meeting with people who want to work together is always good for Debian, and I'll just say okay.
Okay, so I think we are now left with the official discussion. I think what we should do is now is try to find a place for the social committee, both if that's needed, and I think if you want one, it's needed. So the current place would be on the last day afternoon, which might be a bit too late.
Yes.
So we I would try to move it forward and announce in DevConf announce. Would that sound fair?
Yeah.
Okay, then we will do so. I can see one of the organizers wanted to say something, so...
Come, if you want to move something, then come and see us and we can...
Well, I know how it works. I moved all the CBOS. So I will just announce that come for now so that nobody misses it.
Yeah.
And then I would say, we continue this part there and other parts informal. That's why we're here. So thank you very much for showing up here.
Thanks a lot.